Dear Roman Polanski, I'm sure you're aware of Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and I'm sure that the death of Sharon is too painful to revisit, even if the film presents an alternate timeline where Sharon's life is spared and her murderers are brutally dispatched. And yet there's a perverse side of me that's curious about what you'd think. Even though I don't think you'll see the film, there's a few scenes that communicate such sincere humanity. One that especially stands out features Margot Robbie, who plays Sharon in the film. She goes out. She watches from the last movie she starred in, The Wrecking Crew.
The last film she made was not a very happy experience for her.
In one scene in particular, she flutters into a bookstore and buys a copy of Tess of the D'Urbervilles.
Yeah. Getting it as a gift from my husband.
I have to admit that I teared up at this part. I think it's because it reminds me of the opening credits of Tess and that simple but solemn dedication to Sharon after the opening credits. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood also got me thinking about other things, what your career would have been with Sharon. Would you have conquered Hollywood as one of cinema's ultimate power couples, making compelling and original material for years to come? Would this mean that the director's era would have never come to a close? Would studios have not been sold to conglomerates?
I got living next door to me. The director of Rosemary's fucking Baby, that's who.
In the real world is much more disturbing.
You will see a lot of blood all over the place. Cradles, baby clothes, and that's all.
So, can you blame anyone like Quentin Tarantino for dreaming the impossible escapist fantasy, where Sharon doesn't die? I'm sure you feel the same way, but we would like to live in that world as well. The career of Quentin Tarantino also got me thinking about your career. While Quentin Tarantino's vision has brightened with more maturity in recent years, giving us a movie like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, after the death of Sharon, your vision darkened considerably. Once again, can anyone blame you? Macbeth, the first film since Sharon's death, is often seen as catharsis. Is that true? That a classic tragedy was a response to the real tragedy that befell Sharon? I'm sure you're all too familiar with the horrific nature of the crime scene. I also heard that the first policeman on the scene was so disturbed by the gore that he smudged the one clear thumbprint the killers had left behind. So once again, that gets your imagination going. That period after the murder, when they couldn't find the perpetrators, the press turned on you and Sharon.
Sharon not only didn't use drugs, she didn't touch alcohol, she didn't smoke cigarettes, but her greatest picture she was doing was her pregnancy. I never seen a woman more preoccupied with it. The house is open now. The police has released it. And you can go and see the orgy place. You will see a lot of blood all over the place. Cradles, baby clothes, and that's all.
At which point your grief turned to rage, when you discovered that your wife's memory and that of your friends were being buried by the news and media.
In general, I despise the press tremendously.
It's also quoted in F.X. Feeney's book, you yelled, "God damn them." And that you also said, they blamed the victim for their own murders. Another gossip rag, Pageant Magazine, had an article titled, "The Sharon Tate Orgies, Sex, Sadism, Celebrities." I know you often resent any implication that Macbeth is catharsis. When critics made that accusation, you simply quoted, "They're full of shit." Is it also true that your childhood memory of a Nazi officer examining your teddy bear as a child informed the icy malice of the soldiers that killed Macduff's family in Macbeth? I also read that Kenneth Tynan, one of your collaborators who also co-wrote the script for Macbeth, questioned the amount of blood that you used on the set during the Macduff massacre. It's rumored that you replied, "You didn't see my house in California last summer." However, the tragedy came up once more in the filming of Macbeth. As you're applying blood to one of the actresses playing a 4-year-old slain Macduff, when you asked her name, she simply replied, "Sharon."
Now, Sharon, look at me here. And action! Don't move, Sharon, don't move, Sharon, don't move, don't move, don't move, don't move, don't move, don't move. Now you can relax, close your eyes or whatever you want.
There is also some clownish accusation that you had intentionally cast someone who looked like Charles Manson in the opening scene.
You know, I don't like to say it because everybody's, you know, pretty touchy about that Manson thing in California, you know, with his wife. But, you know, he picks a guy to do a particularly brutal scene on the beach, you know. And he maces a wounded soldier to death. And the guy he chose looks just like Charles Manson. And, I was the guy who maced on the beach, you know. So I came a long way to get maced and almost hung by Polanski.
Up and dressed as a man like Manson. And then this thing, remember?
Yeah.
It's really insane because
it's not a very striking resemblance,
actually. This painting is made in 1968. And I made him up exactly like this.
Obviously, you based the idea of the opening scene on the painting, but it wasn't the painting that gave you the idea of doing a film of
No.
Also, I have to ask you, when you see the interviews with Charles Manson, doesn't he look like an asshole? As if he's putting on some act. As an intelligent artist, I can imagine that you can see through Manson's act, and that is nothing more than a crock of shit. Long story short, I'm sure you can tell a cheap trick when you see one. You had also said in regards to Manson and his followers, you had said, "I think they were after money that night." And Manson was clever enough to know that if money came to be viewed as a motive, he wouldn't be seen as some mystifying figure. I can see the sadness, and I can also see the anger in Macbeth. I can't say I understand because I haven't endured a tragedy such as you. I can also glean from it a great deal of insight. Do you think the press and public was too preoccupied with the death of Sharon to truly appreciate Macbeth? However, now it's rightfully hailed as a masterpiece. At the end of the day, I'm not quite sure where I'm going with all this. I guess it's as simple as one person responding to another person's work, or how we interpret and interact with art. Once upon a time in Hollywood got the ball rolling, and this is where it took us. And Roman, I'm pretty sure you'll probably never hear or read this. This is also an artistic exercise for me too. I guess it's also another example of the influence of art and the power of movies and how they can get us thinking and conjure up emotions that we didn't know we had within us. Once again, I guess to reference something I mentioned earlier, I can understand your hesitations to something like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. However, I'm sure you can take some solace in that it's given the public another way to interact with Sharon, a less tragic, a less sad, and more beautiful way to remember her, as she was a very beautiful and wonderful person. And maybe something like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood opens up the public perception of Sharon, and perhaps through the film, we can have a more positive and enlightening interaction with her, something that's not constantly referenced alongside the heinous murders that were committed.